All right, good evening everyone, and welcome to Imagine 2027, kicking off tonight with the Straight Talking and Petty Talk. I'm Alastair Brouard, and I'm with the Cambridge Commons, which is a group behind this programme, in collaboration with Anglo-Ruskin's Labour History Group. Now, Imagine 2027 is big picture stuff, but most of what the Cambridge Commons does is, and it does a lot, is about making Cambridge fairer. It's a very unequal city. So if you want to get stuck in locally, look at the Cambridge Commons. So what's this series about? First, two things really. First, ideas, because for 38 years now, neoliberal ideas about, you know, getting ahead and let the free market rip have held sway. They're not all nonsense, but unchallenged, they've divided us too much and rampant inequality. And inequality rots society. So at last, there is an appetite for change, but we need a coherent vision and achievable objectives. The second thing Imagine's about is joining the dots. Inequality is everywhere. Education, housing, justice, you name it. And these are all intertwined and they feed off each other. So we need holistic solutions, but it helps to see each strand clearly. So each speaker will use one theme as a prism with which to present a vision of a better Britain. We've got five this term, we've got eight next term, including some not yet on the website, like Faisal Shaheen and most recently George Monbiot. Together we'll build those comprehensive solutions, but that's why I hope very much that you'll come to all of these, or at least as many as you can get to. As for tonight, enjoy the ideas, join in, and do give us feedback afterwards. There are buckets for the forms as you exit. If you've got a few coppers to spare for our running costs, fantastic, we need them, lob those in too. In this context, I want to thank everyone on our banner and all our many volunteers for getting this far. So quick admin, Wi-Fi and hashtag are on the screen. The fire alarm will be a real fire. Exits are in that corner and over there, and we're assembling the road. Toilets, leave the room, keep walking as far as you can until you hit a wall, rub your nose, turn left and you'll find it. And a reminder, we are recording these events, so if you have a problem with that, tell a steward or me before you leave tonight. And finally, I'm going to introduce our chair, David Howard. David was 17 years in City Council, three of them leading it. He's then been Cambridge's MP for 5 years to 2010, and he's now Professor of Law and Public Policy at Cambridge University. And David is going to introduce Anne and chair the discussion afterwards. Thank you very much.
The microphone. But one of the few things that being an academic gives you is the ability to talk to the back of lecture halls. As Alistair said, the purpose of these talks is to imagine a better future, 2027. Not so far in the future that it becomes just a matter of short-term politics or of future utopias that are impossible, but practical days, I think, for thinking what can we do now to make things better in a plausible timescale. And so we're absolutely delighted that the first speaker that we have in this series is Anne Pettifer. And Anne will be familiar to, I hope, everyone already, for her appearances on TV, on radio, the journals, where she is one of a very select band of economists allowed by the BBC to appear and to say things that aren't necessary in the interests of the City of London. In fact, I think it's only her. She's director of Prime Economics, which is a network of economists. And I thought I'd just read out their purposes, because I think it sums up quite a bit about what she stands for. a network of economists who seek to engage with a diverse audience in order to demystify economic theories, policies and ideas, and to highlight the glaring failure of mainstream economics to challenge the finance sector's role, explained in part by the profession's blind spot for the role of credit in the economy. Anne herself has worked extensively on the role of financial institutions, on credit, money and debt. I promised her I'd mention that her latest book, which came out in the spring, is called The Production of Money. I think she's going to...
I paid money for that.
Yeah, well, I don't know if money counts anymore. As she makes, but probably Bitcoin. But she isn't just an analyst, she's also an activist, especially in the Jubilee 2000 movement, of which she was a founder and a driving force. So she knows about how to persuade governments to change, not just to analyse what they're doing. So it's a big welcome to Anne. And I should say welcome back, because Anne has been here before. As some of you know, she was a city councillor in a year some time ago. But those of you who were there at the time, nobody was. So Anne's going to talk for about 40, 45 minutes, and we have to end at 8. So we'll take questions after Anne's finished. Thanks. Anne.
Thank you very much. Thank you. It's really wonderful to be here, and really wonderful for you to allow me to imagine the world in 2027. And it doesn't feel like a lot of time, really. 10 years is not a lot of time. If I had imagined where I'd be when I first came to Cambridge back in '68, I would never have imagined that I'd be here. So it shows how important the imagination is, and I'm really happy to be given the opportunity to talk about how our world should look in 2027, because I've spent an awful lot of time being very critical about the way it operates right now. But I thought I would begin with a bit of my story, which is that I was born in South Africa and grew up there. And I started thinking about leaving South Africa 50 years ago and came here in '68. And at the time, I could never have imagined that apartheid would collapse. And indeed, very few people did, because the South African government was armed to the back teeth. The system was so controlled and so powerful, and the resistance looked so weak, and yet it did. Collapsed, and the world was transformed. It's not perfect, but if you go back to South Africa now, it is a very different world, and they're going through some dramas at the moment, which I won't touch on. And then there's the question of the power of the Soviet Union, and the size, and the control, and the power of it, and the fact that, again, nobody could have imagined in '67 and '68 that the system would collapse, and it did. It collapsed in '89. Just simply like that. And the collapse is very quick and very rapid. And then I want to talk about my own experience with Jubilee 2000. So when we began in a little shed on the roof of Christian Aid's offices in Waterloo. And we had no money. We had a woman who annoyed me intensely, actually. She came to see me and said that she's had a vision from God. And God had told her that she had to do something about Jubilee 2000. And I thought, oh, that's all I need. So I was a bit rude to her, really. And I said, well, you know, if we're going to do this, if we're going to get the debts cancelled, we need an office, we need £30,000, and we need a charitable status. And she went away, and 3 months later, we had £30,000 in office and charitable status. And so I was there. Anyway, so we started off on this in this office on the roof of Christian Aid, and it was surrounded by corrugated plastic walls which didn't quite reach to the ground. So in the winter it was quite chilly, and we sat there with our feet up, typing and so on. So we had nothing. Very small, we were very small, had very little in the way of resources. But a few years later, the G8, the most powerful leaders in the world, convened first of all in Britain and then in Cologne in Germany and then finally in Washington, and cancelled $100 billion of debt owed by 35 of the poorest countries. And that was an extraordinary experience for me, it did show me that actually it's possible to change the world, and that actually it's only people, ordinary people, and movements that do change the world. And that's what I want to start with, this quote from Albert Einstein, which is that the world as we have created it is a process of our thinking. It cannot be changed without changing our thinking. And of course, it's entirely possible for us to change our thinking, in particular about the financial system. So I want to begin with that and say that in 2027, we could easily have a very different world from the world that we have now. But what we need to do to get there is to first of all understand the world that we're in. We can't change anything, we can't transform anything that we neither understand or we don't know about. So we need understanding first and foremost. Now, when the financial crisis happened, the world was stunned. We were all stunned. Politicians were stunned. The most stunned of all were the economists. They had no idea this was coming. When the Queen asked them, why wasn't this foreseen, they had no answer. They were embarrassed. Not embarrassed enough to give up their positions, their academic positions or their control over journals, but nevertheless a little bit embarrassed. So people were stunned, but mainly people like you and I were stunned. We didn't know this could happen. We didn't know what collateralized debt obligation was. We didn't know that people were engaged in all this activity in the stratosphere. So naturally, we couldn't do anything about it, and we didn't do anything about it. We sat and watched as our governments bailed out financial institutions. The bailout of the Royal Bank of Scotland was the largest corporate bailout in history. The Bank of England overnight found £1,000 billion to bail out the entire banking system, and not just the British banking system, because a lot of that bailout money went to other global banks, all of them interconnected with the British banking system. And we didn't know that could happen. We didn't know the government could find £1,000 billion overnight. So we just sat there and watched all this. And 10 years later, we're really mad as hell. But anyway, let me come back to this thing. I want to just tell you a story because I think it's so pivotal to the crisis and to an understanding of the system. And it is such a fun story. So this is March 2009. And Ben Bernanke is the governor of the Federal Reserve, the United States Federal Reserve, the most powerful central bank in the world. And he decides to do a television interview. First time ever, central bank governor has given an interview to the TV company, to 60 Minutes. And the day before he gives the interview, he gave AIG, which was an insurance company, and should never have had an account with the Federal Reserve. He gave them $85 billion to help clean up their balance sheets, right? So the journalist says to him, Mr. Bernanke, where did you get $85 billion from? Did you raise it from taxation? Did you get it from the US Treasury? No, 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 he said. We have at the Federal Reserve something that every commercial bank has. It's called a computer. And we entered the numbers, $85 billion, 11 digits, into the computer and transferred the sum to AIG. And that is how all money is created. And it's not quite so simple, of course, and I'll explain why. But that was extraordinary, right? We didn't know that could happen. No federal government had ever appeared on a television show and told us that. And the economists had no idea that could happen. So what's really important to understand is that, of course, they don't just create money out of thin air, central banks. They demand collateral, on the one hand, from whoever's borrowing. They demand that the borrower signs a contract. And they demand that interest is paid on the repayments of that loan, right? And they agree the rate of interest. And of course, in that position, the Fed is very powerful and can set the terms and conditions for the repayment. So it's not just simply creating money out of thin air. There are other institutional underpinnings absolutely essential to that process. But it is what happens every day. And it happens every time you apply for money too, right? When you apply for a loan at your local bank, There is no money in the bank. The bank hasn't got Mrs. Jones's savings that it's going to lend to you, despite what Paul Krugman and other macroeconomists argue. There is no money in the bank for your 350,000 or your £1 million you might need to buy a flat in Cambridge. There is no money in the bank. The bank has a computer and enters a number in a into the computer, but it enters into a contract with you. It demands that you provide collateral. And it demands that you sign a contract and you pay a rate of interest over a period of time, right? And that's what happens. Now, the bank has power, because the bank can deny you a loan. They can say, oh, you're a small business and you're doing something truly enterprising and novel, and we think that's far too risky, we're not going to give you a loan. Or you have a flat in or a house in Cambridge, well, you're going to be a good thing. The house, the value of the house is going to rise forever. So yes, here's a loan for you. 70% of lending by British banks is for residential and commercial property. Right. So that's how money is created. And what's very important to understand about that is that the banks can't do this on their own. Mr. Bernanke could not create $87 billion by himself. He needed a borrower. Where there is no borrower, the central bank cannot create liquidity or money and pump it into the system. So borrowers are extremely important. And that applies also to the money supply. The money supply isn't created by the Bank of England and pumped out into the economy and distributed around the rest of us. You and I create the money supply every time we apply for a loan. Right? If we're euphoric and we make crazy applications for crazy loans, as happened before the financial crisis, the money supply expands massively. And we get inflation in particular of asset prices. But if we are, as now, nervous, lacking in confidence, worried about outcomes, worried about the financial system, worried about whether customers are going to come through the door, we don't apply for loans, and the money supply contracts. In the first case, we get inflation. In the second case, we get deflation. And deflation is far worse than inflation. So that's how the monetary system basically operates. Now, that's been known, if I have to tell you, since 1694, when the Bank of England was founded. But more importantly, since 1705, when an amazing Scottish genius known as John Law wrote books about money and trade. Now, John Law is not highly rated by today's economists, and there's no doubt the man had flaws. You know, he was a murderer. He had killed a man in a duel. He was a womanizer, who's terribly good-looking, aristocratic, and he was a gambler, because he was so brilliant that he could compute the odds of the gambling table and used to win large sums of money. He's not the sort of guy you would trust, you know, to manage your local bank, really. But he was a genius, and he understood, more than anything else, the nature of credit and money. He argued that credit is the thing by which we exchange. It's the means by which we undertake transactions. It's not the means, it's not the thing for which we undertake economic transactions. This is a terribly important intellectual concept. It's the means by which we do something, not the means for which we do something. This is really important because today most economists think of money as a commodity. And they think of the rate of interest as the price of this commodity, depending on the supply and demand for the commodity, right? So Paul Krugman, who's an economist that I rate very highly, writes in his textbook that a loan is an exchange between a patient borrower, a patient lender on the one hand, and an impatient borrower on the other. And the bank simply acts as an intermediary. And that's a deeply, deeply flawed understanding. If you think that's what money is, then you won't understand why we have 300-something% of GDP. 300% debt is 300% of global GDP at the moment, right? Because If global GDP is income, and a bit of that, a large part of that is savings, how come we have debt that's three times that amount? Well, that's because of the way in which the monetary system works. So dear old John Law understood that. I mean, he had other things that have damaged his reputation over time, because he went to France and tried to set up a monetary system there, and got involved in setting up a stock market, in particularly in South Sea assets, and there was a South Sea bubble. And like all the investors in London today, he believed that the prices in his stock market, in his South Sea assets, were going to rise forever. And that was a big mistake, and that blew up in his face. But he was a genius because he understood money as part of a system, that it only exists as a system. And that's why I'm trying to help rebuild his reputation. But that isn't an easy challenge. So money is something that can be created out of thin air, that has no link whatsoever to commodities like gold or silver or oil or whatever, or cigarettes. Those often represent money, but money is not that. As Schumpeter argued, money is nothing more than a promise to pay. Nothing more, that's what it is. It's a promise to pay, probably in the future. And the question of time is really important for money. So when you go to John Lewis's, for example, to buy a washing machine for 350 quid, you take your credit card. And your credit card has no money in it. You haven't put your savings in the credit card account. Very few people put money in their credit card accounts. Am I right about that? Yeah? So there's no money in your credit card account. You go into John Lewis and you hand over your card, and the woman or the man there stamps it and registers it and hands it back to you, and you put it back in your pocket or your bag. And in that process, you have created money out of thin air. You have given yourself purchasing power, the ability to purchase a washing machine. If you don't have that credit card, which says you can trust Anne Pettiford to pay 350 quid for a washing machine, and she's got a limit of up to 1,000 or 10,000. If you don't have that, it's quite difficult to go into John Lewis with £350 in cash. You can do that. But on the whole, that's not the way it happens, right? You have given yourself purchasing power, and that has generated economic activity for the supplier. So John Lewis makes a sale, probably a profit on that sale, and it employs people. And that's the wonder and the magic of money. It's the thing that triggers economic activity. John Law's overriding mission was to do something about the very sorry state of Scotland when he lived there in the early 1700s. It was very poor, it was very neglected, there was no economic activity, there weren't exports, the agricultural sector was neglected, there was no use of fishing and so on and so forth. And he said there was a real problem because the world regarded the Scots as lazy and dishonest. And he writes this in his book. That's what's in the way we think about the Scots today. But at the time, that's how they were thought of. And he said it's because there isn't a properly managed monetary system in this country. If only we could fix that system, there would be money. And he's right. Now, for a monetary system to work, for this bit of magic to work when you go into John Lewis's, it has to be underpinned by institutions. So on the one hand, you need a central bank, right? And the central bank creates, if you like, and values the currency. That doesn't mean to say it prints money, and I want to make this very, very clear. But it's responsible for the establishment of the value of the currency. And the way that it values the, or gets, builds value for the currency is by demanding that taxes are paid in that currency and not in any other currency. Right? This gives it value. And the central bank is backed up by 31 million taxpayers paying money in that currency. That gives the currency its value. The dollar is even more valuable because they've got 61 million taxpayers backing up their currency. And they have a well-developed tax collection system, as do we. Of course, there's fraud and problems on the margins of this tax bill. No, you're not even on the margins, but there are problems. But on the whole, we have a system of tax collection. So you've got to have a central bank, you've got to have a currency, you have to have an accounting system. You've got to be able to do double entry bookkeeping to measure assets and liabilities, claims and obligations, credit and debt. That's really important. You've got to have a criminal justice system that enforces contracts. Without a criminal justice system, you can't enforce contracts. If you live in Russia, you've got to go to London to get your contracts enforced, right? So you've got to have that. And you've got to have a banking system, because the banks are there to manage this process of transactions between me and John Lewis or whoever. If you have those institutions, you have money. Now, I've worked in Africa an awful lot. And I know that in Malawi, for example, they don't have a sound criminal justice system. They don't have an independent central bank. They don't have a sound accounting system with high standards and proper regulation of accounting. And they don't have a sound tax collection system. They don't collect taxes. As a result, they have no money. It's as simple as that. They rely on other people's money. They rely on the dollar, or on sterling, or on yen. And they have to import dollars, sterling, and yen to pay for anything they need. Right? So not having a monetary system is a real big problem. And unfortunately, and this is something I would rant about if I had the time, but the World Bank and the IMF discourage countries like Malawi from investing in the public institutions that would underpin a monetary system. When you go to these countries, they don't have a proper criminal justice system. Their police service doesn't actually enforce laws, really. There's a lot of corruption, there's a lot of degradation of these systems, but they are discouraged from investing publicly in those institutions in order to have a money. The World Bank says, no, don't bother about that. You can borrow money very cheaply on the international capital markets. And we know a lot of people that would like to lend to you. Right now, the IMF World Bank annual meetings are taking place. And I used to go to those regularly every year. And they are nothing but a forum for flogging money to the finance ministers of developing countries. Oh, you see them in these big, great limousines driving around Washington, the bankers. And then wander into a hotel and there's some poor African finance minister drinking his old grey tea and signing contracts with J.P. Morgan or Goldman Sachs or some new vendor. And their public don't know this is going on, right? Because they don't have a monetary system. And they're discouraged from doing that. So when we have these institutions, we have money. Which is why I think, and this is contrary to quite a lot of what is argued about in NGOs and on the left, I believe the monetary system is a great civilizational advance, right? We invented this monetary system to enable us to do what we can do. And that's what it enables us to do, right? It's extraordinary. But it's a system that can be captured. It can be captured by others. We have lost control over it. But the reason I want to talk about 2027 is that I believe we can regain control over it. And why do I believe that? I believe that because we've done it before, and not so long ago, in my lifetime. Between 1945 and 1971, public authority managed the global financial system, managed the domestic monetary system, kept it stable. I haven't, tonight I especially didn't bring my PowerPoint presentation because I think PowerPoint is so blah. But I have a fantastic chart from a book by Ken Rogoff and Carmen Reinhart, mainly Carmen Reinhart with a bit of Ken Rogoff, which has a chart showing you all the financial crises since 1800. And the chart goes like this, da 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 da, and you get to 1929, you go boom up there, and then it comes down, crash, and you get the World War. Then you get a flat line all the way to 1971. And then financial crises begin, and they culminate in 2007-9. They begin on the periphery of the global system, and they gradually move towards the core. When they begin on the periphery, you know, in poor countries, in Latin America, in Africa, and then in Russia, and then in Southeast Asia, the countries that the court said, oh, it's because these black people can't run their economies, it's because they're incompetent, it's because the Japanese model doesn't really work, etc., etc. And then it gradually moved to the core and blew up the core. And Rogoff is a very famous Harvard economist, and I meet him periodically at George Soros's conference he organizes every year called the Institute for New Economics. And one year I said to him, now look, Professor Rogoff, how do you explain this flat line here and the absence of any financial crisis? Ah, he said, yes, we did it then, but we can never do it again. I'm here to say that by 2027, we can restore that flat line to the global financial system. Okay, so how do we do that? Well, I think, first of all, and I'm rather nervous, actually, because I discovered that David is something of an expert in international financial law and knows an awful lot about this stuff. So, and I'm very nervous anyway, because Professor Volker Heiner is sitting there, and he's a very distinguished physicist, and I'm surrounded by very distinguished people here, so it is nerve-wracking. I have to tell you, that's if I sound a bit nervous, I am very nervous. But I want to say this, that it is possible for this world to change. And how do we do that? Perhaps I'll begin, I'll start with another little story, which is that when we designed the Jubilee 2000 campaign, we had to think about how to do it. And the more we spent quite a lot of time thinking about how to analyze the system in order to make change possible, right? And I talk about that is that it's a bit like cutting a diamond. When you go to these wonderful places in Holland where the diamond cutters are, or Belgium, they take a rough old diamond, mainly from Africa probably, and they look at it when they get it. They look at it for 2 years. They just look at it for 2 years. And then eventually, they think about how it should be cut. And when they cut it so that it shines, that it's true at very many, the facets of the diamond are true. And we know what that means. It means that they're as clear and as light as possible, reflecting light. So that's the same thing we have to do in order to analyze the global economy and then think about how to change, how to frame the change and so on. And I think that's what I want us to do. But at the moment, the first thing we have to do is spend 2 years understanding the stone, understanding the system. So for me, the first thing that has to be done is that we as citizens have to brief ourselves on the way in which this financial system works. We have to, if you like, read the Financial Times. You know, and it's not rocket science, let me assure you. If I can understand it, you can understand it, right? We have to get a grip of this, and I'm addressing this, as I do in my book, to women and to environmentalists in particular. Why? Because we're the ones who are always told, sorry, there is no money. There's no money for looking after people's Alzheimer's. There's no money for looking after children, and there's no money for investing in education, and there's no money for creating works of art, and new dramas, and wonderful theatre, and marvellous music. No, there is no money for that, right? And we believe it. We believe it. Well, we did believe them until they found £1,000 billion to bail us back. Then we started to get a bit sketchy. We believe it. Right now we have a government telling us that we can't afford even to prepare for Brexit. Very interestingly, today, Philip Hammond's in the Times saying, we know where to get the money from when we need it. He said, the necessary funding, he said, will become available, but I'm not going to tell you now where it is, and I'm not going to spend it now. What he said, which is why the Tory party is in disarray. So we get told there's no money. And we believe it. We go along with it, and then we get mad as hell because schools are closing, whatever's going wrong, and we blame everybody else except those perpetrators responsible for designing and building and creating the system and benefiting and enriching themselves from the system. something like. So first of all, we have to spend a lot of time trying to understand. So what I've been trying to do here tonight is just to give you some inkling of the nature of money and credit. But then I think the really important thing is we have to understand our power. We have power. We have leverage over the system. And I think we've got to grasp that we have power and leverage over the system, right? Especially women. We think we don't have any power, but we have it. There's this wonderful quote, which was once attributed to Nelson Mandela, but actually is from a sort of hippie-type woman working on spiritual stuff, when she said, our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. We're scared of it. Yeah? Because we might have to act. We might have to do something uncomfortable, and we're scared of that. We'd rather not think of ourselves as powerful. So I'm arguing that we are powerful, and it's about time we started to understand the power that we have and to leverage it, to use the language of finance. So the first thing to understand is that the private financial system depends almost entirely on the state. Without the state, it would not exist. And it starts with the central bank and the currency. Right. It starts with the currency and the maintenance of the value of the currency by the central bank, by any means, right? It starts with the central bank. So, and the central bank, our central bank, is a nationalised bank. We nationalised the Bank of England in 1947 because the governor of the Bank of England, Montague Norman, had messed up so majorly in the 1930s and made the British people suffer unbelievably. He was reckless and stupid and wrong. And so Labour government came in and nationalised the bank. The bank is still nationalised. It's effectively another government department, right? We need to understand that. It would not exist without taxpayer funding. We need to understand that, right? All of the people working in the Bank of England are civil servants. They're not private entrepreneurs, right? They are civil servants, meaning they're employed by the state, paid for by the state, appointed by the state, and sacked by the state. Now, there is a pretense that Gordon Brown would have us believe that there is some distance between the government, the political arm, and the monetary arm, and I think that's really important. I've worked in Nigeria, where the politicians regularly go across the central bank and help themselves to US dollars, with which to buy a new jet or a new house in North London or whatever. So, it is really important for the political arm to be transparent in its dealings with the central bank, and I'm in favour of that, right? But it is still a nationalised bank. It's our bank, right? Without it, the global financial characters working in the global financial system would be nowhere. They are heavily dependent on it. So we need to understand that money is peculiarly a creation of the state. Without it, it would not exist. The private sector is dependent on the public sector to sustain the monetary mechanism through which the private sector accumulates its wealth and realizes its profits. That's all you have to understand. When you get that, you begin to think about it slightly different. It's not that these types of geniuses and they're able to do, you know, they're not like John Law, they can compute the odds and do really well. Most of them are really not very bright at all. In the sense they hurt themselves. So the taxpayers are responsible for this system and for ensuring its integrity. So the private financial system is a liability on the public sector, on you and I, as we discovered in 2008-9. You know, we had to cough up £1,000 billion and we were told that in order to prepare the state for another financial crisis, we had to endure austerity. We had to contract economic activity. We had to, you know, do all the things we've done, including lower wages in real terms, in order to keep the system alive. And we all fell for that, right? So what we have is a public system on which the private sector is dependent, which is a liability for us, but there's very little in the way of benefits for us. We should also have a public benefit out of this system and always be assured of it. The next thing you understand, I'm sorry to have already explained, is that the currency only is valued in the way that it is because of the taxpayers. take the taxpayers away, you'd be like Malawi, right? We are the taxpayers. We pay our taxes. We fill in our PAYB forms. We fill in our returns at the end of the year and so on. We do it faithfully. That's what gives, that's, we're doing it. If we don't do that, the tax collection system weakened, they would have no currency to play with. We bailed out the system. We guarantee deposits in private central banks, right? Now that's as a commercial bank, sorry. So that's extraordinary. I mean, if you were growing tomatoes and the government came along and said, we will guarantee your tomatoes, the value of your tomatoes and the price of them, don't worry about this, you'd be okay. We will say, no, that's not the market, that's not how the market works. But we guarantee deposits in private banks, up to £80,000, I think, is what you found. Now that's a lot of money that taxpayers, and a big liability for taxpayers in the event of a crisis, as we've already known. The other thing is that the private banks borrow money from the Bank of England. And right now they borrow it at something like 0.25, 0.5%. Do you pay 0.25% on your overdraft? No. If you've got a little shop and you've got an overdraft, you're paying 28% to HSBC or one of those other banks, right? But if you even take out a mortgage, you're paying 4%, 5%, 3 to 5%. And in real terms, given what's happening to inflation, that is very high. In real terms. Imagine being able to borrow at 0.25 and lend at 4%. Imagine being able to borrow £1 billion at 0.25 and lend £1 billion at 4%. Oh, what a way to make money. Who would ever grow tomatoes? So when you grow tomatoes, you have to engage with the land, you know, the climate, whether the rain will fall, the sun will shine, and labour, whether labour goes on strike or not, right? You've got all these problems. Enter numbers into a computer and make a risk assessment on a loan, which is the only work you do, and you earn loads of dosh because you borrowed at 0.25 and you've lent at 4. Hallelujah! Who'd not want to be in that business? Right? And that isn't the most profitable way to make money in the financial system. It's just one way. So, thanks to our central bank, they enjoy low interest rates. And those low interest rates have got nothing whatsoever to do with the supply and demand of money. They're determined by a committee, the MPC, appointed by the Chancellor. Men and women. The price is fixed by men and women. At the time of the crisis, rates were higher. Men and women brought the rates down. Every rate of interest that you pay on a loan is determined by a person in a risk assessment process. And I will pay more than someone who's a professor and very reliable and so on and so forth. And I will pay less than someone like the Saudi princess. Okay? So that variation, the spectrum of loan of interest rates, is not determined by market forces. It's determined by the risk assessed inside every single bank. So banks get the benefit of those low interest rates. And then they have access to something called central bank reserves. Now, reserves is a funny word. It sounds like savings. They're not savings. It's a bit, about 10 minutes. It's a bit like an overdraft. They get an overdraft, effectively, and they get it in this form as central bank reserves. But that means, just like when you have an overdraft, that they can go and spend, and they do. And so QE is a way in which the finance system, people operating in particular part of the financial system, offer collateral to the central bank, and in return they're given, effectively, this overdraft, which enables them to spend and invest further. Right? So they have access to that. You and I can't go to the Bank of England and ask for this kind of overdraft. Right? It is only available to financial institutions that the Bank of England decides are able to have an account with the Bank of England. And in the case of AIG, who should never have had an account with the Fed, they were given one because they were a systemic threat to the global economy. So they have all these assets. They have all these wonderful things provided by us, the taxpayer. Finally, they have something that is the most valuable thing to them of all. And David's an expert in this. It's called collateral. Right? Now, collateral is when you when you apply for a loan, you have to show that you've got already got a property or some other asset, which the bank wants to have a grip of in case you default. But when you're operating out there in a global financial system, beyond the reach of regulatory democracy, there are other things that are important to you as an asset. And the most important thing that provides the most important collateral of all is sovereign debt. So British gilts and US Treasury bills are what hedge funds, gamblers, private equity firms, and asset management firms require in order to exchange with the central bank and get a bit of money, stroke overdraft, right? Without that collateral, they wouldn't be have access to the central bank. No, I mean, that's not entirely true. A lot of them, David will confirm this, are offering a lot of really rotten, toxic, it's called, collateral. And sometimes that's corporate bonds and so on. But that's a small part. Really, sovereign debt is a thing they're all desperate to get their hands on. Right? Now, sovereign debt is the spending by governments on what's essential for our economy. Right now, governments across the world have been contracting their spending. Austerity has really been fashionable since the crisis. So they have been issuing less debt, less requests to borrow, right? Less gilt and less treasury bills. So there's a shortage of these assets. So the price of these assets have gone up and the yields of them have gone down, right? But there's a desperate shortage. So what's happening right now, and David will tell us more about this, is people are taking sovereign bonds in the what is called the shadow banking system, which is beyond us. In that banking system, they're using collateral, if you like, to create new forms of money, right? But because there's such a shortage of collateral, they use it and reuse it and constantly value it and revalue it, right? And sometimes they've even invented, we were discussing, something called synthetic collateral. Now, these are guys that live in that cloud cuckoo world, which created the crisis in 2007-9. But that's our collateral. If we didn't issue sovereign debt, they wouldn't have the thing that they need to deal with our central banks. These are our central banks, right? So personally, I'm in favor of creating more debt because there is a terrific shortage at the moment. And anyway, we could deal with money because we've got an awful lot that has to happen. You know, we're going to be confronted by climate change. I live in Suffolk and we're going to be flooded. Sure as God made it or take it. You know, first of all, the country's tilting into the sea, and secondly, you know, the tides are rising. And we need flood defences. Our houses are deeply energy inefficient. We need to retrofit all our Victorian properties. There's so much to be done. We've got people with Alzheimer's. We've got children who could be geniuses, whom we're not really teaching. We've got works of art that could be created. So let's create more sovereign debt, in my view, and do that. But the point I want to make is this. If we understood our power, we would say to the central bank, thou shalt not allow asset management funds, who currently manage something like $87 trillion of our pension funds, to deal in our collateral unless they agree to certain terms and conditions, that they put money into. First of all, that they pay their taxes, you know, you could just ask them to do that. Secondly, we could say, you can't take money out of this country without also putting more money back in it. But there's all kinds of terms and conditions we could apply. But we don't. We simply believe that this thing works as magic, and those guys are clever and powerful, and we give it away. We give away our power. I want to say that if by 2027 we haven't discovered our and we haven't used it, God help the world, you know. God help the asset management funds. They're all going to go bust because they're all engaged in crazy activity in shadow banking. So it's absolutely vital that we get to understand the system and that by 2027 we've transformed the system. Thank you very much.